Good morning, Integrity Church. It is such a blessing to be here in the house of the Lord this morning together. Amen. I'm going to ask that you would stand and let us just fix our eyes on Christ Jesus, the reason that we are here. Let's worship him this morning. This first song is a confession of all that we believe. Believe in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right, let us worship him this morning.
Salvation, one doorway that leads to life, one redemption, one confession. I believe in the name of Jesus Christ. I believe in the crucifixion, by his blood I have been set free. I believe in the resurrection. Hallelujah, his life is destiny. All praise to God the Father. All praise to Christ the Son. All praise to the Holy Spirit. Our God has overcome. The King who was and is and evermore will be. In Jesus' mighty name. Place for me, far beyond what hearts imagine, ears have heard or eyes I've seen. I believe that day is coming, he's returning to claim his bride. Light the altar, keep it burning, see the Lamb who rose a roaring light. All praise to God the Father, all praise to Christ the Son, all praise to the Holy Spirit. Our God has overcome, the King who was and is and evermore will be. In Jesus' mighty name, I believe. Yeah. The King who was and is and
Your grace will be enough. Your grace will be enough. Under fire, but we won't fall. We will never be alone. You'll always be enough. You'll always be enough.
Your kingdom and everything else will follow, Lord. We thank you that all we need to do is keep our eyes on you, Lord, and we thank you for the opportunity you give us, Lord. So we make that the prayer of our hearts this morning, Lord. Above our own desires, above whatever the world shouts at us, Lord, we simply just want you. We love you, Lord, and you're worthy of all the glory and praise this morning.
Blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are the ones in need, for every thirst and every hunger, you are everything. Blessed are the worn and weary, blessed are the ones who grieve, and every moment unexpected, you are everything.
The doors fling wide, I see glory as I run inside the throne room before you. I bow. The veil is torn, the doors fling wide, I see glory as I run inside the throne room.
You are holy, Lord. There is nobody like you, Lord, and we are so glad to be in this place worshiping you in spirit and truth, coming before you to give you the praise and honor and glory that you are so due. When we think about what you did on that cross, when that veil was torn, we were given access to your throne room. We had direct access. A priest did not have to intercede for us anymore, but we could come directly to you, Jesus, and then through to the Father to receive forgiveness, to receive wisdom, to receive grace and compassion that we are to dispense to others around us. So, Father, I pray today that as we continue to hear from your word, God, that you would speak to our hearts, that you would give us minds to comprehend what you're saying and wills to carry out your will, Lord, for us to this world that so desperately needs to hear about you. And we ask all of these things in the precious and matchless name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
Amen. What a wonderful time of worship this morning. You may be seated. I'm going to ask if the ushers can come forward. We're going to take our offering. You know, this past Thursday, we just started a study with our young adults, a Bible study, going through the book of Philippians. And, you know, as we were kind of covering the context, we found that the book of Philippians is in much part a thank you letter from the Apostle Paul to the church that is at Philippi, specifically for their financial support of the ministry. And throughout the book, you'll see this language that is used of participation and joining, partaking in the ministry. And that's how Paul talks to the Philippians as they give. And Integrity Church, that is exactly what takes place when we give. When we give, We are partaking in, joining in the ministry of God's church. And let that be in your mind as you give this morning, that it's not just to some random organization here. We're talking about the kingdom of God. We're talking about the gospel being preached, lives coming to faith in Christ Jesus. That is why we do this. And I just want to thank you for your faithful giving, just as Paul thanked the Philippians. Thank you for your faithful giving this morning. We give because of what Christ has given to us. And let's keep that in mind. And will you pray with me? Father God, we just come before you, and we are so grateful for the ultimate gift, your Son, Jesus, our salvation, our life. Lord, we do not deserve such a gift, and yet you give it so freely. And we're just so grateful for that, Lord. And Lord, out of our gratitude and our joy, we now just give just a portion of what you've entrusted into our hands. And we ask that you would receive it, Lord, and use it for your glory. We ask that Christ would be glorified, that your church would continue to be built and established, and your kingdom built here on earth as it is in heaven. We love you, Lord. We praise you. It's for you that we are here. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I'm going to ask if Pastor Tom can come up for the announcements.
Well, it's great to see you all today on this beautiful sunshiny day. Is everyone enjoying the summer? Yeah, it's good stuff. Amen. Well, just a couple of announcements for you. First thing, just want to remind you that we have the Police Appreciation Day coming up on September 7th. It's going to be from 1 p.m. to 5 p.m. Again, it's a great opportunity to reach out to our community, especially to our police who protect us and take care of us. So if you're interested in joining in on that, please register online. That would be great. Also, I wanted to remind you that our church picnic will be coming up the following week. That's September 14th. It's going to be over Cathedral Pines, a great time to get together, to enjoy one another, enjoy some food and fellowship. So you'll be hearing more about that, and you'll have the ability to sign up for that as well. And finally, we do have our women's conference. That's going to be coming up on Friday, September 27th and the 28th. You should be able to register for that next week, so get excited about that, ladies. It's really going to be a great time. Pastor Tony.
Oh, that's right.
That's right, exactly. Well, good morning. What a powerful time of worship this morning. Amen. It's good to see you. It's good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Would you stand with me as we go into the Word of God together in our scripture reading? Psalm 1 says this, "Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And on his law he meditates day and night." I like that. Blessed is the one who's not influenced by the ideologies and the mindsets of the world, is what he's saying. "But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. In all that he does, he prospers. The wicked are not so, but they are like chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish." How many want to follow the way of the righteous, right? We must be in the law of the Lord. Amen. And his word, meditate in it day and night. Before you're seated this morning, I'm going to encourage you to take a moment and welcome one another and extend a greeting to one another in the name of the Lord. Well, you're going to be blessed this morning. Today is Mission Sunday. Our last Sunday of the month is always Mission Sunday. We focus on our different missionaries and things that we have opportunity to come alongside. And this morning, we're really excited to have Rob Chestnut with us. Yeah, give him a... Do you know how much I had to pay them to do that? It was like crazy, right? Rob is no stranger to Integrity Church, and he and Audrey have been family here. And so it is a pleasure to have him with us. Rob is out in the Czech Republic. He is working with Josiah Ventures. You can come on international. And I introduced him this morning as the Pope of Europe, as he is influencing the Evangelical Pope of Europe, actually. And he'll share a little bit about the ministry he's involved in, and I know he'll challenge you this morning, but it's always a privilege to have you. So welcome.
Great, thanks.
Yeah.
Good morning, Integrity. It is really great to be back with all of you this morning. I want to especially thank the youth group for starting that pre-clapping. This is how you influence young people, ladies and gentlemen, okay? You go, you speak their language, you say words that you don't understand, but they feel endeared to you, and so therefore, TikTok. I think that's how it goes. Anyway, yes, the Chestnuts were here. I'm Rob and my wife Audrey. We have some photos we wanted to show you this morning as well. This is our family. We look like this every day, by the way. And that's my wife Audrey, my daughter Stella on the left, and Adria on the right. And we are serving in the Czech Republic in the city of Ostrava. Ostrava is the third largest in the country, a city of about 300,000 people, kind of a Bethlehem, Pennsylvania vibe. So we have steel mills and coal miners. They're lovely, warm, friendly people. And one of the things that is always really great to come back to Integrity is just to be able to say thank you for all of your support for us, but also to be able to just come back and say, hey, I want to give you an update on, sure, it's what we're doing in the Czech Republic, but you are an integral part of this ministry. And when we were here last summer, we just kind of got to queue up and kind of say, hey, we're jumping into this next school year, because again, our organization, Josiah Venture, is focused on the youth of Central and Eastern Europe. And our mission statement is a movement of God among the youth of Central and Eastern Europe that finds its home in the local church and transforms society. Everything we do, every activity we have is always tied back to a local church. And so for us to go back to our own local churches and say, hey, this is what you actually are a part of, is really encouraging. So today I just wanted to give kind of an overview of what our last year has looked like coming into this time frame. So we'll just jump through some photos here, like I said. So here we have our international team. So JV is about 350 missionaries all throughout Central and Eastern Europe. And so we go from Estonia in the north to Albania in the south, and all those countries in between, those former communist countries. And if you have no idea what those countries are, it's okay. Geography is not anybody's strong suit ever, all right? In full disclosure, my kids have no idea what these United States are. Like, why is Pennsylvania? I thought it was just America. What do you mean there's differences? Also, lots of questions about Indiana, but that's for another time. Anyway, so our international team, we help to facilitate all of the different ministries that take place in each one of our countries, because to do ministry in Czech is different to do ministry in Bulgaria, is different to do ministry in Latvia. And so we are kind of the headquarters, if you will, and this team is made up of our finance department, our operations team, our summer ministries team, our web presence, our online, our training department, our communications team. If you go to our website, or if you pick up one of our little prayer cards, they made these. So this is the behind-the-scenes crew, if you will, and this is my team. I co-lead this as well, and it's really just a privilege because we get to be the ones who equip and enable all of our local ministries throughout our region. And it's just, and they're honestly a lot of fun too. They're great people to be with, and I'm excited by that. We usually kick off our year in September with our annual fall conference. And so if you go to the next one, fantastic. So this is our fall conference. We always, we have about 400 youth leaders, again, from Central and Eastern Europe, all come to the Czech Republic. And this is a week-long event that we do to kind of kick off the school year in terms of saying, hey, what's our primary focus? What do we want to be aware of? And this year we talked about mental health and how best to address the issue of mental health, because as we've seen, not only here in the States, but also in our neck of the woods, a huge increase, an uptick in the needs of young people. We have been through 4 years of chaos, of 2 years of COVID lockdown and restrictions, and then 2 years of war, to now come into this word that people are starting to use again called normal. And normal is strange because there's still a lot of underlying issues, and we see this coming out in our young people today. So we go to the next one because we actually invited Dr. David Van Dyke from Wheaton College, who's a marriage and family therapist, to come out and be our guest speaker and teacher for the course of the week, because he was able to equip all of us of how to be a first responder to this anxious generation. We see a lot of the needs of young people we are not able to figure out, for lack of a better term. And honestly, in full disclosure, the nature is, well, let me just learn everything I possibly can about this topic, and then I'll be able to fix everybody. Okay? How's that going for us? Yeah, great. Yeah, not so great. Good, good, good. So instead, he said, no, we've got to take a different approach to this. And I'll talk a little bit more about that a little bit later. But so this is our kickoff event. But from there, we move into kind of, you know, smaller activities. Audrey, along with her role on the international team, helps to care for the Josiah Venture women throughout all, again, of our different countries and our teams. And so this is just a snapshot of her. She hosted our ladies women's event this year. These are all the ladies on the international team. And that was just a fun event for her to be a part of, but also, again, to kind of create these little hub groups within the different countries. And so they kicked it off as a starter, and it's been exciting to see how that's expanding outward from there. Next up, we move into a realm of digital missions. So like we said, kids today are spending all of their time reading books and being outside. I'm just kidding. Of course not. They're on their phones. We all are. No, it's not a joke. So, hey, how do we address and engage with the tools that are kind of in front of us? What do we do within this space? Now, this does not mean we are starting channels and things along this line. We know our place, thankfully, and it is not online. But it is encouraging to meet this, like, 16-year-old Serbian kid, and you go, like, oh, dude, what do you do? And he's like, well, I make videos to tell people about Jesus. So I'm like, oh, that, you know, and in my mind, I'm like, oh, that's sweet. Isn't that cute? Oh, that's neat. And I'm like, and how many people watch your videos? 40,000? Okay, I need to do something different. So we want to encourage our digital missionaries, if you will, in this space. And this is something we've been moving towards. But move out of the digital space and move into the next one, which is, this is our Edge Sports. This is our very first Edge Games. Edge is our weekly ministry that is tied to churches and sports, basically like a church softball league, essentially. Yes? We have some awareness of this. Again, sorry for your loss. I've heard a lot of talk and grumblings about this, but yeah, too soon. I'm sorry, but you know, there's hope. There's always next season, okay? It's always next season. But so we do a sports ministry, and basically what this is through football, or as you like to say in this country, soccer. So we do see that. That was helpful. I said football the first service, and I had a couple of people come up to me like, you guys play football? I didn't have a lot of pads on. Like, this is weird. Anyway, so we do football, we do floorball, but what this is a local church will kind of adopt a team. They'll host a team, and they will play year-round. In fact, other churches will play other churches, and this is a competitive opportunity. And really what's neat about Edge Sports is there's about 1,000 young people every week that will go to a church, be a part of a team. They'll hear a gospel presentation every week. They're building relationships. And this goes out year-round. And what's fascinating, as we said, because this is one of the ministries that really attracts a lot of the guys, and especially in some of the countries down, say, Albania, Romania, Moldova, some of the more impoverished areas, they say 80% of the guys that are a part of this ministry have no dad. So outreach and relationship is really critical in this area. And this was our very first event to get all of the teams from all of the countries together in one location. And we did a week-long tournament, just like a World Cup type thing. So here, this is a picture from the final. The final was between Moldova and Romania, which was really fun because if you know anything about ethnic tensions between former countries that were forced to live together, you know, they get along really nice. Really, really nice. And the highlight of this game was when the captain of the Moldovan team, after the Romanians had scored a goal, ran down the field, grabbed one of the other guys by the neck, and just like punched him as hard as he possibly could. It made for a really great outreach experience. So, but this is the nature of people we're working with in different ministry opportunities from our sports ministries. But then also we move into higher education. We're also doing some school stuff. And so in this one, you can see this is our Four Mission team. And Four Mission is our education arm within the international team of JV. And it's an opportunity for leaders, primarily like youth leaders, things along this line, to come and get a bachelor's in a Bible degree. And what Audrey's been doing over the course of the last couple of years is helping with the cluster dynamic, because it's not just school, but it's also school and formation. So the students who are going to school are also working in their local churches, being a part of different youth groups, being available, and they all get together every week online and talk about different ministry things, catch up. And so Audrey has been the cluster leader over the course of the last year, and that's just been a benefit not only to them, but it's great to see just the opportunities of this training up this next generation as they move into other opportunities through education. I've also been going through a master's program, if you go to this next one, through Wheaton College again, and a master's in leadership. And one of the things we're doing is I'm working and reading lots of books I never thought I would read, ever, all the time. It's just a constant stream of opportunities and things to expand, but then also pieces that I can take along with a number of members of my team, and then we get to pass this on throughout our organization. So an opportunity for learning has been really encouraging. I've writing more papers and replying to more things. And again, so much reading. Nobody communicated this ahead of time. But it's been good. It's been great. I'm excited about that. But we're not the only ones in school. We also have two other actual students full time. And so if we go to the next shot, this is Stella's class. She just finished up the fourth grade, which is really, really exciting. Both of the girls go to Czech public schools, which means they go to school, they come home, and they speak a different language automatically, okay? They don't have to study, okay? They don't have to go to classes. They just go to school, come home, and they are fluent. It's not fair. There's just no other way around it. It's just not fair, but it's really fantastic. So this is Stella's school in the nature. Once a year, her whole class goes off into the woods for a week, and they do just like regular learning like they would in classes, but they do it out and they hike and go all around, just like in America, right? Exactly. And we'll go to the next one, which is Adria's class. There's my little Mets fan. Yes. We are lone wolves out there, folks. Let me tell you. But it's what's been really encouraging, really, for this school is an opportunity just for us to expand relationships and connections. The girls being in school has provided us with so many more contacts. We interact with parents on a regular basis. And what's really great is it's like, how do I put this? We're weirdos, because who in their right mind would move to Ostrava, Czech Republic, willingly? And like want to live there. So we've been able to have great relationship with the parents. It's also really funny because our church, our local church, has been able to, we're there. We've got two other families from our small group who sends their kids there. Our pastor's daughter goes there. One of our elder sons goes there. We have another missionary family that's moving in. So we're kind of slowly taking over this school, which is really, really encouraging for us. And again, just to see the nature of relationships spill outward has been super encouraging. So the girls actually pull us into the front line of ministry in a whole new way now, which we've really, really been encouraged by. And then I think just the last one, if I remember correctly, yep, this was our tail end of our international team, our last event before we all moved into summer ministry phase. We do this thing called paper plate awards, where you write on a paper plate something meaningful about somebody else on the team. And I was gifted with the professional clown award, because to be the funniest person in a room full of missionaries is not that much work, but you can do it. So that's kind of our year as an overview of just what it looks like in our neck of the woods. And again, I want to say thank you to all of you for your part in this ministry. You are having an impact in Central and Eastern Europe in the lives of young people. We're about 32 million young people, and less than 1% of them have a relationship with Jesus Christ. And so what Integrity is doing from Estonia all the way in the north, Albania all the way in the south, and the countries in between is massive. And so we just want to say thank you again for all that you are doing for us. Yes, absolutely, absolutely. But summer is an incredible time because Czechs, like I said, they are a cold, kind of cut-off people. They're not very outgoing in a lot of environments, but summertime does something to them. They become nice. just ever so slightly. And it's great because, you know, when you interact with Czechs on a regular basis, they'll always say, dobrý den, which is good day. You know, dobrý den, dobrý den, dobrý den, dobrý den. But if you're outside of the country, like on summer vacation or something along this line, and you meet another Czech, it is like you just made a best friend for the rest of your life. It's incredible because they're like, what are you doing here? Where are you from? You know, they want to know all these different things. There's something about this dynamic of being strangers that sometimes welcomes people into quicker relationships. But there's another aspect, too, of being stranger. Sometimes it's a little more like, I don't know, I want to deal with this. So we travel a bunch. And in fact, when we flew to America, we got on a train to then get on a, well, we got on a bus to get on a train to get on an airplane. And in every one of those environments, you're inevitably sitting next to someone else. And I don't know about your connection to seatmates and strangers or things along this line. Even sometimes in church, you've got your own seatmates, you know. There's the, some of you have the, you know, the single seat buffer between, you know, the person next to you and that sort. But sometimes we find ourselves put in positions where it's like, well, I just have to sit next to this person for the next 9 hours. And then it's this whole question of like, am I going to make eye contact? Am I going to acknowledge your existence? Like what, how do we interact with seatmates? It's a fascinating, like human experience, if you will. We have a good family friend, though, by the name of Fred, and every person he interacts with for more than like 6 seconds, he automatically labels my friend. And so he'll, you know, you'll say things like, hey, who was that guy? Oh, that was my friend Jeff. Who's Jeff? Oh, I don't know. I'm like, do you know his last name? No, not a clue in the world. But that's Jeff? Yeah, that's my friend Jeff. You know, oh, that's my friend Ron. Oh, yeah, that's my friend. See, there's my friend Ron. He's in the back. Hey, Ron. And so sometimes, you know, it's this automaticness. And I was like, Fred, how can you just call everybody your friend? But yet doing so, he kind of removes this barrier. There's this warmth that just kind of comes into the picture. And I was fascinated by that. But then this past year, as I was going through school, we had to take a class with a professor of psychology. And whatever image in your mind you have of a psychology professor, that was this guy. Okay, I mean, patches on the elbows, you know, kind of scraggly beard. You know, he would sit and he would just pontificate on the universe with his freshly cut flowers that he just brought from his garden this morning. And he would just sometimes just go, and you're like, I don't know if I should write this down or like report this to someone. Like, what is happening? You know, whatever. But he said this profound thing in one of our classes, which was, remember, every person is made in the image of God. Do you agree with that, church? Every person is made in the image of God. So therefore, if every person is made in the image of God, that means that you have something to learn from every single person. There is intrinsic value in every single person you come in contact with. Now, do we live that way? I mean, again, now we go back to that seatmate conversation, right? I didn't think the person that was sitting next to me for 9 hours had anything to teach me whatsoever. My dynamic is one of, and it's interesting, we put people in categories, situations, we want to keep barriers sometimes, but yet if we truly believe that everyone is made in the image of God, that everyone has value, everyone has the potential to be our friend. And what do we do, though, in a world where so many people, where we do get close, where we do move a little bit, like people are hurting, people are struggling. Chaos seems to be the name of the game. We've been in the United States 1 month, and the things that have happened in 1 month are enough to fill 3 years. And yet, that alone, sometimes just like, how do we handle, how do we manage? And as I said at the beginning, we are in the midst of a mental health crisis, the likes of which we have never seen on planet Earth, primarily within our young people. And so what do we do in that area? And the reality is, though, it's not just even the young people. It's spreading out to other generations. The statistic that I found is that 1 in 6 people in mainland Europe lives with a mental disorder such as anxiety, depression, and bipolar every single day. This is a silent army of more than 110 million people. So what do we do? What is our response? If this is what the world is looking like around us, how do we even possibly begin? And so as I said at the beginning, we approached this conference to say we actually needed to be first responders to our anxious generation. Do we have any first responders in the room, as a matter of fact? I'm just double checking here. No? Okay. Ooh, sort of, maybe. Nurse, fantastic. We've got a nurse up front. If anyone feels faint, nurse up front. Great. So we have first responders that, and what do first responders do? They're the first on the scene, correct. They're the first on the scene. And the thing about first responders, though, can they diagnose every single thing that's wrong with you? No. They are there just to fix, they're there for the immediacy of the situation. So what do we do for the immediacy of the situation? Because when we had spoken to Dr. Van Dyke to come and do the conference and say, hey, if we just teach you everything, you know, then we'll know everything. And how is that working for us? It's not working. So we got to do something different. So actually what's really neat is if you look at scripture, there's two different examples, two different stories that you can draw from to be a first responder to a hurting world, and that is what we're going to look at this morning. So if you can go to Luke chapter 24, that's where we'll start. Luke 24. Now this is the story of Jesus on the road to Emmaus. He has just risen from the dead in context, but yet it's only a few people know this. It's a very limited number of people. And actually what we find when the story begins is there's two disciples who are on the road going. They're talking about what had happened. And as I was preparing for the message, one of the commentaries said, this is a perfect illustration of people today, okay? Because think about it. They had a belief in something. They were hoping for something to happen. Jesus was going to destroy the powers that be. Opportunity was on the horizon. Everything was going to go great. But what just took place? He died. Right. What happens when your boss dies? Well, maybe when your boss dies, that's a different story. But when the person that's going to lead a revolution dies, you know, that's going to take over stuff, he dies. What happens next? You're lost. Right. Everything falls apart. Everything that you thought was going to go right is now completely destroyed. So what on earth are you possibly going to do? And that's the story of Cleophas and his friend, because think about it. They had all these plans. Everything was going to be great, and it blew up right in their face. It even shows the story. They're huddled together. They're talking to each other. Their body language is even described in the story. And along with that, even the way in which they respond when Jesus engages with them, they're cautious. They're not sure they want to answer because it's like, well, who might you be? You know, everything has gone wrong for them. And when I think of a lot of people today, especially when I think of young people in Central and Eastern Europe, a lot of things have gone wrong for them. 4 years ago, kids that were getting ready to like move into college, they were like, I got the whole world in front of me. 2020 is going to be my year. Whew. And so we went through 2 years of crisis and COVID, and then we go into 2 years of war in mainland Europe, something that was never supposed to happen. What on earth are you going to do? Everything that I thought was going to take place is blown up in my face. Where do I go? Where is my hope? What is next? So let's look at how Jesus actually engages with people in this story. So, verse 13, now the same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. And as they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked among them, but they were kept from recognizing him. So think about this. As they're going along, they're walking, Jesus comes up. And I don't know about you. Do any of you like go for walks in the woods or something like this? Is there nature to walk in Long Island occasionally? Sometimes? Some, there are some, okay. So have you ever been walking, or maybe you go walk on the beach, is that better? Okay, we get some beach walking, okay, all right. Conditional, I get it. There aren't many sidewalks, I understand. But have you ever been walking, like out, you know, in public or something along this line, and as you're walking, there's, you know, you're aware of someone else nearby, but then as you're walking, someone suddenly is going the same pace as you. Ooh. Yes, someone just, I mean, gut instinct from the crowd. Have you been walking and suddenly you realize there's someone here and they're my same pace? Like what is going on in your mind and your body right now as you think about someone walking close to me at the same pace? Yes, concern, absolutely, concern. Same thing. Audrey and I, before we came to the States, we got one last walk in our woods, and as we're walking, another gentleman came up beside and then was walking at the same pace as us for a concerning amount of like 2 minutes, okay? And in that time, you're going like, okay, do I slow down? Do I speed up? Like, is he going to slow down? Like, maybe tie my shoe. Yeah, tie my shoe. That's great. That's great. Okay, great. Oh, we broke in stride. But it's funny. If people are in a close proximity to us, we go like, whoa, what's happening here? These two are so concerned with the situation, are so overwhelmed by the situation, they're not almost even aware that Jesus comes up and gets close. But this is actually the first step that we need to be aware of if we're going to be first responders to people. We need to get close. We need to be close to people who are hurting. And there's actually kind of two parts that goes to this one. Not only do we need to be close to people that are hurting, but we also need to move at the same pace as those people who are hurting. Oftentimes I've heard it referred to that God moves at 4 miles an hour, because that is the speed at which a human being walks. And so, church, we need to move at 4 miles an hour as we come alongside those people that are hurting. We need to come alongside and we need to move at their same pace. We need to be close within this space. So Jesus is walking alongside with them, and then something happens next, but it's a little more indirect, because if you go back in verse 15, as they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. So what is Jesus doing as he walks alongside both of them? He's listening. Exactly. He is listening. And so this is actually step number two, but we have to explain it a little bit more, because I don't know about you, I've been married for almost 18 years now. I had to correct it from the first service. And if you ask my wife, I have been an incredible listener the bulk of our marriage. I mean, just absolutely stellar. When she starts talking and pouring out her heart, I am intently listening to what she's saying as I prepare for the next words that I can say as soon as she pauses. Okay? This is sometimes the nature. And I think for a lot of us, when we listen to people, especially if we, you know, you ask somebody something, they start talking, are you actually listening for understanding, or are you listening and preparing what you're going to say next, you know? You're like, you know, here's the wind-up and they're done. There it goes. You know, boom, it comes out quickly. No, what we actually need to do with people, again, who are hurting, so we need to draw close, we need to be close, move at their same speed, but then we also need to listen for understanding with what is coming out of their mouth. We need to hear from them what is on their heart. And actually what you see, Jesus, so he, in verse 17, oh sorry, I'm getting ahead of myself. So we need to listen. We need to listen first. That's what Jesus does. He listens for what is going on with them. Then we come up to the next part. Okay, so he's walking close. He's listening. He's not jumping ahead or telling them what to do. Then verse 17, he asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. So what does Jesus say? What does Jesus do in this next step? So he's drawn close, he's listened, then what does he do? He starts asking questions. Right. Okay. So let's think about this, folks. Okay, have you been in a situation where someone maybe is going through something, and maybe you've done step one. You've gotten close and you're listening. Great. Oop, I'm going to move the mic there. You've gotten close, you've listened, and then, you know, now you're ready, but what's your natural step three? I'm going to tell you what to do, right? Okay, you communicated a bunch of, again, I work in youth ministry. I've been doing this for a long time. The natural process for me has been, you know, I am sad, I fix your problems, the end, go away. So that's not what Jesus is doing. He actually engages and asks questions to pull out more information from people. Okay, so one more time, let's think about this. He's close, moves at their speed, then he listens, then he asks them questions. And what's fascinating for this, what I really enjoyed, is kind of a little bit of a contrast, if you will, because in the beginning of the book of John, when Jesus first comes onto the scene in the book of John, and we know the beginning of John, and the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God and with God. But what's the first thing that Jesus actually says in the book of John? And if you don't know, it's okay. It's down there in verse 34. He actually, the first thing that comes out of his mouth is a question. What are you seeking? And what's fascinating about this is, as Jesus is going, two disciples are following them, and Jesus responds with a question. And now the risen Jesus, who is back from the dead, mission accomplished, is now following two disciples, and the first thing again that comes out of his mouth is a question. Jesus is asking questions, and this is something we need to be doing, church, asking questions of the people around us to really understand and know what it is they're seeking. What are they looking for? So again, all right, so step one is? Get close. Great, okay. Step two? Listen. Step three? Ask questions. Okay, so we go through those three. Let's move into step four, all right? Verse 25. So he asks what happens, and they explain everything of what they'd experienced. And then in verse 25, Jesus says to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all of the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. Now, maybe for some of you, you read through that and you go, oh, great, this is where we get to yell at him. Step four, my favorite, fantastic. So, okay, I remember it now, Rob. I'm close, I listen, I ask questions, and then I say, how foolish of you. No, that's not what I'm encouraging people to do here. What we're trying to recognize is by the time you get to that step four, this is when you have an opportunity to actually point people to Jesus. This is where the opportunity to open up scripture takes place, all right? Oftentimes, I can speak for myself. I've been in scenarios where someone comes and they complain about a situation or something that's going on, and I go, well, you know, if you just boop, you know, they don't even finish their sentence, and I'm like, here's your prescription. Boom, be done. Go away. Leave me be. I've fixed it, right? That is not what is happening in this space. As believers, we have an opportunity to be close, to move at the speed of people, to listen to them, to understand them, to ask things of them. And then in that understanding is where we're then going to be in a space where they will be willing to open up, to listen to what we have to say. And that's when we have an opportunity to point them to Christ. And this is fascinating. I love it even as I was putting it together. Another commentary said, the reason the disciples couldn't recognize Jesus is because they could not recognize the story. And only in the story, when Jesus begins to unpack and explain the situation, that's when they got it. That's when it clicked. And I think a lot of times for the people around us, they have a problem. They have a situation. They're looking for something else. And if we just come and say, the church has X, that's not what they're looking for. But when they're ready and you open up and you have the opportunity to explain and unpack, then that's when they recognize, oh, this is what I need. This is what I've been looking for. So, all right, one more time. Let's go through it from the beginning. Step one, get close. Step two, listen. Step three, step four, point people to Jesus. Okay, a little sketchy on step four. Step four is Jesus, okay? Step four is the Sunday school answer. So you can land the plane on that one. And now maybe to some of you too, you're thinking, okay, Rob, great. I always love it when preachers give examples of Jesus because what could possibly go wrong for me then? Thanks for using, you know, the one with no sin. How is this helpful? Well, guess what? We've got one more story, folks, okay? So let's go to Acts chapter 8. Because we've got another example. If you go to Acts chapter 8, verses 26. And this is Philip and the Ethiopian. And so if you do know the story of Philip and the Ethiopian, just think about what we've been talking about. And if you don't, let's just walk through it real fast. So verse 26, an angel of the Lord said to Philip, go south to the road, you know, go along the way. 27, so he started out, and on his way he met Philip meets an Ethiopian, an important official. And the Ethiopian is on his way home, sitting in his chariot, reading the book of Isaiah the prophet. And the Spirit told Philip, go to the chariot and stay near it. Then Philip ran up to the chariot and heard the man reading Isaiah the prophet. Do you understand what you were reading? Philip asked. How can I, he said, unless someone explains it to me. So he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. This is the passage of scripture the eunuch was reading. He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. In his humiliation, he was deprived of justice. Who can speak of his descendants, for his life was taken from the earth? And the eunuch asked Philip, tell me, please, who is this prophet talking about, himself or someone else? Then Philip began with the very passage of Scripture and told him the good news about Jesus. So, church, let's break this down real fast, okay? What does Philip do first? He gets close. That's right. I don't know if you've ever walked alongside a chariot before. You know, traffic's weird on the LIE these days. So, you walk close, you know, but here's the thing. He's able to move at the pace that the chariot is moving, correct? Okay. Then what does he do next? He listens, correct. He's listening to what he has to say. And then what does he do? He asks questions. And this actually, what's really interesting in this one, Philip says, do you understand what you're reading? And the guy says, how can I, unless someone explains it to me? So then he says, hey, come sit with me. Tell me what this is. Now look at this dynamic. Think about this. If we draw close to people, if we listen to what's going on with them, and then we ask questions, what does that provide? It provides an open invitation. Actually, it's an invitation to say, actually, no, here, I want to know what you have to say. I'm interested to what you have that I can't seem to figure out. And then lastly, what does Philip do? He directs him to Jesus. He points, he unpacks the scriptures and gives the Ethiopian eunuch exactly what he needs. And what happens? The eunuch right there puts his faith in Christ, gets baptized, and Philip gets transported magically someplace else. Now, that's not going to happen to you. Okay, I just want to go ahead and just put that in there. No teleportation included within this process, all right? No, that's not how this goes. But again, it's an opportunity to be a first responder. It's a first responder situation. You are going to encounter people who are hurting, people who have issues and problems, and you are not going to be able to fix all of them. And here's the other, I want to highlight this as well too. We are not here to fix people either. If you get close and move slow, you can't do this with a prescriptive mindset, all right? We've got to love people. We've got to be different in the way in which we approach those around us, because you cannot listen with a prescriptive ear and you cannot ask questions with a prescriptive ear if you're just trying to fix a situation and be done with it. You've got to go about it differently, because you can't open the scripture and love and point people to Jesus if you're just trying to get them out the door and be rid of them. So church, one more time, let's talk through this process. What's step one? Get close. We want to get close. Step two? Listen. Step three? Ask questions. And step four, point people to Jesus. Congratulations, you've all now passed your first responders test. Pastor Frank, if we could have certificates ready at the back door, that would be great. Thank you. The reality of this, folks, is this is applicable to all of us. Like, you can take this right now out into your workplace, to your schools, to your friends, your family, whoever it might be. We are salt and light. We are hope to a world in need. And we need to be reminded of ways in which we can meet those people right where they are to be that help, to be those first responders, just as Jesus did. So let me pray for all of you. Father God, I'm grateful again just for an opportunity to be reminded of how I need to live in the world, how I need to view people through a different light, how I need to move at a pace that is not my own, a pace that is slow, that I need to listen. God, that I need to ask questions of the people that are hurting around us, and then I have an opportunity to point them towards you. Lord, I pray for this church as they go out into their mission field, that they would be first responders to so many hurting individuals here on Long Island. And God, I ask that you would bless them, go before them, and encourage them as we all go forward in your mission together. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Rob. Yeah. What an encouraging, practical word we just heard. So thank you, Rob. Appreciate that. I'm going to ask if you can stand, and we're going to close in our last song, and let this be, this last song, a prayer in light of the message that we just heard. Let this next song be a prayer from your heart that the Lord would speak through you to the world around.
Before my being, you saw purpose. call my name into the light. Consecrated for your kingdom. Have your way within my life. Instill in me a fearless passion to obey all that you say, to follow you into the unknown, so that my faith is all that remains. Breathe your breath into your light shine through my life. You are my hope and my future.
Lord, I'm yours. When you said I will go, here I am, Lord, I'm yours. When you said I will go, here I am, Lord, I'm yours.
Let that be. Yeah, we could. Glory to God. Let that be our prayer every morning. Lord, here I am. Send me. I'll go. Let this week be an opportunity every single day to be the voice and the heart of Jesus to the people that he puts around you at work, at the gym, the grocery store, and elsewhere. Let the Lord use you for his glory. If you need prayer, come forward. The elders would be happy to pray for you up front. Otherwise, go enjoy some fellowship in the family room. God bless you. Go in peace.